to stay depressed all the time if we wanted to think about it. But there's a way around it. And the way around it is to concentrate on the Christ and not the crisis.
Amen.
Pray with us. Father God, we thank you for this honor, this privilege to be in your house. It's very humble. We come to the point of our service where our pastor comes and he shares with us not his words, but your words.
Yes, God.
And dear God, we can pray that he allows your spirit to flow through him, that his words, that your words flow from his mouth.
Yes, God.
Dear God, we just pray that you will be with him, that he will be bold, that he will be strong,
yes,
and he will remain in the truth. And dear God, as listeners, may we hear what you have for us. Because you're speaking to all of us, not just one of us, but you're speaking to all of us. We all have needs. And dear God, we all experience storms in our lives.
Yes.
And we're so thankful, dear God, that you're the loving and merciful God that you are, and that you will always be there for us, no matter what. Dear God, be with our pastor in a mighty way. Allow him to do your will and not his. Thank you for loving us even when we're unlovable. And dear God, we thank you most of all for your son, Jesus Christ. For his name we pray and ask these things. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Thank you.
Amen.
Amen.
Just so y'all know, I worked with Dana all night on that song until she finally got it right. I'm lying, and I'm sorry. All of the musical talent in our family happens to come from the girls. Singing talent. Parker plays an instrument. Me and Noah just barely can play the radio. But anyway, today, this morning, what we're going to be looking at is giving and receiving of talents. And we have been in this series, Generous God, for some time, a couple of weeks now. And we've talked about various things, ways that God is generous and ways that we're to be generous with those gifts that he's given us. This morning, we're going to be looking at talents, and then we will be looking at treasure as well. Last week, we looked at time, how God has given us time, and we've all been given the same amount of time. We've all been given 24 hours in a day. And as you and I were talking about, you don't get rollover minutes. That you just get 24. And you can't make up time. You remember the myth we talked about? Well, this morning as we look at chapter 25 of the book of Matthew, the portion of scripture we're going to be looking at is 14 through 30. But we're going to be looking at a particular area of that, and that's what I want us to look at and read this morning. And it's Matthew chapter 25, beginning in verse 20. We're reading from the New King James this morning, and it is on the screen behind me, and you don't have that copy of Scripture, but I'm going to ask if everyone would stand as we read from God's Holy Word. Verse 20 of chapter 25 says this, "So he who had received five talents came and brought five other talents, saying, 'Lord, you delivered to me five talents. Look, I have gained five more talents besides them.' His Lord said to him, 'Well done, good and faithful servant. You were faithful over a few things. I will make you ruler over many things. Enter into the joy of your Lord.'" Pray with me if you will. Heavenly Father, we come before you once again just to thank you for allowing us to be here. God, I pray that you speak through me. Dear God, hide me behind your cross. God, it is my intention to be authentic and to speak your holy word. God, cleanse my heart that I may be pure, that you may speak through me. And dear God, open the hearts and the ears and the minds of each one here. Dear God, I pray that that if there's anyone lost, that today would be a day of salvation for them. But dear God, I pray for those that are here that know you best, that dear God, today is a day of repentance, and today is a day when we come back to this morning, as we begin to look at this topic of generous God, the reason I didn't read all of that passage of Scripture from chapter 25, verses 14 through 30, is that most of you know that particular Scripture. You remember that what happened was is that it was a parable given by our Lord, and what he said was is that this master of the land was leaving, and he found these three servants, and he gave them each a portion, or each a portion of talents. And also, we're not going to get into the money value of those talents, but what it says is that the first one was given how many?
Five.
Okay, and then it says the next one was given how many? Two. And the next one was given how many?
One.
All right. And it says that he went away, and then he came back. And when he came back, the one that had five had doubled them, the one that had two had doubled them, and the one that had one had taken it and buried it. And he came back and he gave it back, and we're going to talk about all the things that ensued after that. But now you've got sort of the general picture of that Scripture that we're going to be looking at. And this morning, what I'd like to do is sort of set the basics on talents as it is described in the Bible. Number one is this: each is given a talent by God. There's two things that I want to say about this, as hopefully all of you have those little sheets this morning. All of you have one of those? Okay. The sermon guides. But anyway, each is given a talent by God. The thing I want to tell you about this, is that each one is given a talent. Now, some were given more, some were given less, but everybody got at least one talent. Okay? And that gift, that talent came from whom? It came from God. So here's the thing that we've got to understand as we go about living our life, is that as believers of Jesus Christ, he has endowed each and every one of us with a talent. He's endowed each and every one of us with a gift. Okay? Now that gift belongs to who? It's a trick question, right? Well, it belongs to me, right? No. It belongs to God. God is the owner of it. We are the steward of it. Which means that what we have to do in being good stewards is we have to take what God has given us and we have to use it for Him. We'll understand this more, that He's coming back one day and we'll have to give an account of what He's given us. But what I want you to understand first is this, is that everyone has a talent and that it is given to us by God Himself. The second thing I want us to look at is this. Each talent is given accordingly. Now, if you go back and you read that particular section of Scripture, what you'll see is that God gave those talents according to the ability of each person. Meaning that some He gave five, some He gave two, and some He gave one. Now, does that mean that He loved the one that He gave five more than the others? No, it does not mean that. Does it mean that He didn't love the one that He gave one at all and just gave him one? No, that's not what that means. So don't try to read something into this that's not there. What it says is this, is that each person was given a talent according to their ability. Now, I don't know about you. I've just described my ability to sing and my ability to play music. I can't do it. And if I were given the responsibility of Brother John here to lead the choir, I would be miserable. That's why God gives gifts and abilities, gives talents and gifts and abilities so that we can use those for God. And Brother John is using his for God. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. But you see, that's the reason they're given according to abilities, because God has blessed some to go in certain places and others to go in other places. We are all part of the body of Christ. And each one is a different part, but it fits together so that we make up one whole. We're all part of the same team, amen? And we have to use those gifts and abilities fit together accordingly as God gives them to us. The next thing I want you to see is this, is that each person is accountable for their own talent. Now, I'm not going to sit up here and tell you that you know what, you should be trying to use is not your talent. Because, see, the truth is that you are the one that are accountable for the talent God has given to you. You're the one that one day will have to provide an answer to God for what He's given you. You're the one. I am the one that's going to have to answer for what God has given me. But I can't answer for you, and you're not going to answer for me. We each answer. We're all held accountable. And that's so very important because we've got to understand the basics of this parable that was given is this. If you'll go back and you read chapter 25, chapter 24, and get just barely into chapter 26, what you'll see in that particular part of Matthew is that Jesus is describing the coming again, His second coming. And He talks about the virgins and the oils and the lamps. That's one of the parables that He gives according in conjunction with this. There's a couple of parables right in a row. And all those things have to do with being prepared for the second coming of our Lord. You see, one day when He comes back, we are going to be held accountable. Now, for some people, that's a scary ordeal because we've not done a very good job of stewarding what He's given us. But for some, that's going to be a glorious day. Because when He comes back, He's going to bring us home. When He comes back, He's going to pat us on the back and say, "Well done, good and faithful servant. Enter in the joy of my kingdom." Praise the Lord. Then I want to tell you a pet peeve of mine. I got time. I'm going to tell you a pet peeve of mine. One of the pet peeves of mine is that so many people talk about how one day, boy, they're going to spend an eternity in heaven and they're going to walk streets of gold and they're going to see all the pearly gates and they're going to live in a mansion and all this kind of stuff. And they talk forevermore about heaven, but they miss the point. You see, the point of heaven is not streets of gold. It's not about eating good food. It's not about never gaining weight. It's not about all that other stuff. It's about being in the presence of Almighty God. That's what heaven's about. And brothers and sisters, I don't care if heaven is an outhouse out back. If it's me and God, then hallelujah. So never miss that point. But brothers and sisters, understand, one day we're going to have to give an account. The last thing is this. There will be a test at the end. We were handing out those sheets today, and somebody says, "Is there going to be a test?" Yes, there is. But here's the thing. You're not going to have to answer my questions. You're going to have to answer God's questions. You see, everybody is going to have to give an account, and there is going to be a test. What did you do? And then there's going to be rewards handed out accordingly. What did you do? What did you do? Let me ask you this, church. What are you doing? What are you doing with what God has given you? Are you spending it all on you? Are you letting it waste away? Are you spending it for God? Let's move forward. The next thing is an invitation to joy. You see, as God has blessed us with various gifts and abilities, as God has blessed us with everything that we have. Nothing is ours, it all belongs to God. But what He does is He invites us into His joy. If you go back and look at the verses that we just read, chapter 25, looking at verses 20 and 21. If you go back and look at the end of that verse, into that particular portion of Scripture, it says this, is that when the master came back, that the servant had an opportunity to give an account. And he was offered a chance to enter into the joy of his master. Now I want you to think about this, and I want you to understand this, because this is very important. The second coming of Christ brings judgment and joy. It brings judgment and joy. Now in the church, we like to talk about judgment a whole lot. That's right to talk about that. As a matter of fact, sometimes we get so bold as to say, of course, not in Baptist churches we don't do this. Right. But what we like to do is we like to say, oh, brother, come to judgment time. Boy, they've got a hard time coming, don't they? Did you ever hear anybody say that? No? Yeah. Unfortunately, I have. Good folks say stuff like that. But brothers and sisters, I want to tell you, the judgment is coming for everybody. But here's the point of what Jesus is saying in this verse. It is not to be fearful, but to be prepared so that when your time comes to give an account, that you won't focus on the judgment, but you'll focus on the joy and the fact that Jesus has come back and that you have done what he told you to do. We should focus on the joy that'll be there. We should focus on the fact that if we're prepared, it is going to be a glorious time. Because rewards are going to be handed out. It ain't going to be no participation trophy. Okay? It's going to be, what did you do with what I gave you? Each is given a chance to give an account. Now I want you to think about this. Each one is given an opportunity to give an account. But I want you to understand the second part of this as well. Okay? The first part of it is that each one is given an opportunity to say something before the master. Each one is given the ability to say, well, this is what happened. This is what I did. But understand this, the master has the final word. The master has the final word. The next thing I want to share with you is this. Is that each is given an opportunity to share in the master's joy. When the master comes back and talks to the one who had the 5 talents, and the one who has the 5 talents says, look, Lord, this is what I did. This is what I did. I took those 5 talents, and now I have 10, and here I give them back to you. You see, that's what a good steward does. A good steward understands that what they have is not theirs, it's somebody else's. And they're excited about the opportunity to give it back. And to give it back with interest. The one that had 2. Look, Lord, you gave me these 2. And I have 4. And I give them back to you. And notice what the master says. Well done, good and faithful servant. Enter into the joy. Enter into the joy. I want you to notice that word, joy. It's not happiness. Happiness comes and goes. Happiness is an emotion. It goes like this. Joy is something that remains constant. And as we do our best with what God has given us, and we invest those talents, and we're able to give back to God the produce from them, then God doesn't give us happiness. He don't just give us a fleeting good feeling. He gives us joy that wells up inside. The storm is blowing you around. And though the sails are torn, excited that it is. When I got married, the fear and the joy. Dang, I asked and asked to marry me. I finally gave me in. I'm kidding. But standing at the altar, I'll never forget, standing at the altar and thinking, she's really going to go through with this. I'm sure many of y'all weren't there, were you? But you see, joy is something that we have to express. It's not just a happiness about one thing or another. It's a joy that is deep within us. So what should I do? Number one is this. Remember that Jesus is a gracious God, not a hard man. If you go back to this parable, what you'll see is that the Master is a gracious Lord. He's a gracious Lord. You see, he didn't have to give any talents to anybody. If you think back to our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, he didn't have to give us anything. And I want to tell you something. In the society that we live in today, where everybody's complaining about somebody else getting something, and I didn't get this, and you got this, and, well, they're living in a better house than me, and they got better cars than me, and they got all the breaks in life, and I didn't get any, and all this stuff. Let me tell you something. Stop it. Stop it. If you got what you deserve, you'd be in hell right now. You see, that's what I deserve. I deserve hell and damnation. To be eternally separated from God. But because of God's grace, because of his mercy, he loved even me. And he loves you. And he doesn't give us what we deserve. He gives us what he wants us to have. And the fact that we have anything at all is a gift from God. So quit your complaining about all the other folks and all the stuff they've got. And be glad for what you've got. And use what you've got for the glory of God. If all you've got is two pennies to rub together, praise God for the pennies. Because there's a lot of people that don't have that. Oh, I don't like these clothes. I don't have any money to go buy anymore. Kind of buddy, I just got back from Africa. I wish I could show you the pictures. If I can get with him, I'll give you the sense of the pictures. But there's people there. He sent me this picture, and I can't get it out of my mind. There's a picture of a church that he's walking from place to place to go to these villages and different places to meet these people. He left a street where a church met on the street. Not because they didn't have a church building, because the people didn't have any houses. They met in an alley on a street. And he left there and he went to another place, and as he came up, he heard singing. And there were about 100 people gathered there. And what they did is they walked through a dump. And that's where the church was meeting. The people in the church, in order to make money, they took stuff that people had thrown away and they took it to the recycling center where they got pennies to live on. And here we are complaining about stuff in this country. We just need to shut up. Thank God for what he's given us. He is a gracious God, not a hard man. The next thing I want to share is this. If we're to invest our talent, don't hoard it. Invest our talent, don't hoard it. I love the illustration Jeff used this morning. That was great, Jeff. That was great. I'm going to get some candy, by the way. But I think that's wonderful, because here's the thing that we need to remember about our hearts. From the overflow of our heart, our mouth speaks. What we put into our heart is what we can use blessing other people. of our Savior Jesus Christ, and that we need to be constantly dishing it out. Because the only way we can get more in is to put more out. That's amazing, isn't it? I had a man show me that one time. I've told you this illustration, but I want to tell you something. Somebody put a dollar in my hand. And they said, hold on to it as tight as you can. Man, I grabbed that dollar. Y'all don't know me that well, but I grabbed it. And I was holding on to it. And he had a $100 bill. And he said, now take the 100, but don't let go of the 1. And I said, I can't do it. And he said, that's right. He said, this is a lesson for God. In order for God to bless you with more, you've got to be open with what you have. How about that? You've got to invest what you have. God will bless you with more. The last thing is look forward to sharing in the Master's joy. If we do what we're supposed to do, if we invest, if we understand that God is a gracious God, then when the second coming comes, then it's going to be a time of joy and celebration. And we're not going to be concerned about the judgment. I want to share something with you in closing. And I'd like for everybody to listen up. There are some people here that have been Christians for a long time, and you've never experienced the joy of generosity. And you've never experienced the joy of salvation. And you've never experienced the joy of all that God has to offer. And that bothers me. I've talked to believers that have been believers a long time, and they say, Brother Brent, I understand what you're saying, but I don't feel that. I don't have that feeling that you talk about. This past week, and I was telling John about this past week I talked to a buddy of mine, a pastor, and he's a pastor of Ozark, Alabama. And I was sharing with him about how this church is praying for Bo McGill, and how Bo got saved. And praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Been praying for 11 years. Bo gave his life to the Lord 2 weeks ago, baptized last week. And Scott said something to me. He said, well, you know what I did last week? And we're not trying to outdo each other. We're just talking about how God has blessed us. I said, what did you do last week? And he said, I baptized a deacon. And I said, you baptized a deacon? I said, I don't understand that. He said this. He said, after church one day, this deacon came into my office and he said this. He said, Brother Scott, he said, you talk about this assurance of salvation, and you talk about this joy that we have when we serve God, and you talk about this wanting to share, and you talk about this desire to do God's will. And he said, I don't have any. He said, I wish I did. He said, but I don't. He said, I don't have that desire. I don't have that burning within me. I don't have that joy of my salvation. And they sat down and talked. And at the end of that talk, that man prayed and received Jesus Christ for the first time. Scott said he'd been a deacon for years. But when he read his Bible, it was just like reading a book. And when he prayed prayers, there was no relief or release. And when he tried to do Without that, you'll never know what I'm talking about. With God being generous with time, with God being generous with talent, with God being generous with treasure. Because all these are biblical principles and they apply to believers in Christ. Church family, I'm not here to make you doubt your salvation, but I'm here to make sure that you are saved. And if you're here today and you've never experienced the joy, if you've never experienced the peace, then don't leave here today without giving your heart to Jesus Christ. When I talked to Scott, I shouted hallelujah. But then it scared me because I thought, how many people do we have that come to church that have no joy because they have no peace, because they have no safety? Today is the day of salvation. If you've never experienced that before, experience it today before you leave. Some people here today need to experience that. Some need to experience the coming back to God. Some of you may have had that joy, that burning desire at first, and now it seems like it's getting further away. Maybe there's something that's come between you and God, and what you need to do is you don't need to be saved again. What you need to do is you need to repent. You need to repent of the sin that is in your life that is keeping you from experiencing that. And you need to give it over to God and don't pick it back up. Whatever decision you need to make today, I pray that God has spoken to your heart. And I pray that one day you will hear, "Well done, good and faithful servant. Enter in to the Master's joy." Pray. Heavenly Father, we come before you right now asking you to speak to our hearts. Lord God, may your heavenly host surround us. May your Holy Spirit fall on us. Lord God, I pray that you speak to our hearts. I pray, dear God, that you break through the places that are hard and cold. God, I pray that you help us to understand everything that we have is a gift from you. And dear God, as we share in that you bring us joy unspeakable. Lord God, I pray that if there's someone here that has never experienced your joy of salvation, that today's the day. And I pray, dear God, that you speak to us in a mighty way. God, I pray decisions are made, hearts are open. God, I pray nobody is ashamed of coming forward and kneeling down at the altar and praying. I hope and pray, dear God, that you bust this place wide open. God, it is in your holy name we pray. Amen. The words of our final song are from the Lord behind it. Today, God's speaking to you. If you need to make a decision, please make it today. Our altar is open. Please feel free to come and pray. If you'd like somebody to pray with you, I'll pray with you, or there's others that will. Ladies, there's ladies that will come and pray. Men, there's men that will come and pray. Whatever you need to do, do it today as we stand and sing.
Yeah.
has spoken to your heart. I pray that you've made decisions wherever you are, and I hope that you've had a blessed day, and that you have a blessed day. Let me make a couple of announcements. Number one is this. Today in our dining room at 2 o'clock, there's a bridal tea for Kim McCreeless and Brian Christopher. This is Charlotte Christopher's son, and everyone is invited. And Miss Charlotte is in the back, and we are celebrating with her son getting married. She'll be done with sons getting married after this. So we're excited about that. All right. Also, you'll notice that inside your worship bulletin, there was a copy of the budget. Adam, did you say anything about that? Okay. Be discussed next Sunday night. Okay, we discuss it. All right, we discuss it next Sunday night, and we're going after that. All right. Anyone else? No? I don't see anyone else.